thank you very much indeed for a very nice introduction, and thank you all for coming out on a rather rainy morning to listen to someone talk about the First World War. And I'd like to thank the National Arts Centre Orchestra as well for being such a wonderful orchestra and for being here. And as a Canadian, of course, I'm very pleased that we are reminded in the United Kingdom that this was an empire effort in the First World War, and that soldiers came literally from all corners of the world, and of course many of them never went home. 100 years ago today, people in Europe and elsewhere were beginning to realize that what so many of them had thought would be a short war, a war that would be over by Christmas, a war that would be decisive, was in fact not going to be any of those things. A number of people had welcomed the war, not necessarily everyone, but a number of people welcomed the war as you would welcome a thunderstorm on a very sultry day. There had been a feeling in Europe that the tensions were building up and that it might actually be good to have some sort of thunderstorm, some sort of explosion, after which life would go on as usual. And what they were beginning to realize by the end of October 1914, 100 years ago to this day, was that it wasn't going to be like that. That the losses taken in battle were going to be much greater than they had imagined. Some of the worst losses, the greatest losses in the Great War, were in fact in those first few months of 1914. That the losses were going to be enormous, and that the war was in very great danger of turning into a stalemate, which of course is exactly what happened. And that was what was meant to be a war of just a few months, in fact, was going to last. They didn't realize this, but it was going to last certainly into the spring of 1915. Indeed, of course, it was going to last into the autumn of 1918. There's a story that Ernest Shackleton, the great Antarctic explorer, which is true, I believe, because he tells it in his own memoir, that Ernest Shackleton had left for his exploration of the Antarctic as the war was breaking out in Europe, had a harrowing journey across the Antarctic, had eventually made his way back with his expedition to South Georgia Island in the spring of 1915, which was the first contact he'd had with the outside world since he'd gone off to the Antarctic. And almost the first question he asked was, who won the war in Europe? And they said, no, it's still going on. And he was absolutely dumbfounded. He said they must have all gone mad. And that indeed was a feeling that many people had at the time. The war continues, I think, to haunt us for a number of reasons. It has shaped our world. It shaped the world of the 20th century. I think it also haunts us because its costs were so high. And again, those costs, I think, still are shaping the world in which we live and which we have lived through. And we all know what those costs were. The lives lost, some 62,000 Canadians. In total, some 9 million men died in the First World War. We will never know how many, because the records weren't always kept that accurately. At least twice as many were wounded, some of them never, of course, really to recover from those wounds. Empires disappeared. Austria-Hungary, that great multinational empire which had for so long kept a sort of peace at the heart of Europe among many different ethnicities and religions, fell to pieces, and smaller nations appeared, most of which rapidly fell to quarreling with each other. As Winston Churchill said in 1919, he said, the war of the giants has ended, and the wars of the pygmies have started. And Europe and the Middle East were going to be marked by a series of small wars throughout much of the 1920s. Russia, of course, had had a revolution. And I think it's fair to say that without the Great War, Russia would not have had that sort of revolution, the one that it actually had. It might have had change. It was probably going to have great changes. But the fact that the Bolsheviks took over in 1917, I think, is directly traceable to the First World War. Germany had a revolution. Hungary had a revolution. The Ottoman Empire was going to fall to pieces in the years immediately after the First World War, and that disintegration was speeded up by the war itself. Not only that, but the world as a whole was affected. I think it was a time when we realized something which we've come now to take for granted, and that is just how interlinked the world is, how something that happens in one part of the world can have severe consequences in another part of the world. We in Canada have just become, I think, very much aware of this because of what happened last week with the shooting of the soldier in Ottawa and with the running over by a car and killing of a soldier in Quebec. We've realized that we are part of the world whether or not we like it. And I think the First World War was a time also when that realization was born home. One way that people realized it, of course, was that their young men went off to fight and their societies were changed, no matter how far away. Some million Indians came from India to fight in the Middle East or to fight in Europe. And if you go to places like Ypres, you will see their names, along with names from Australia, New Zealand, Canada, as well as, of course, British names, French names, Belgian names. People came from around the world, and then as the war ended and they went home, they took back with them a number of things from the war. They took back with them new ideas, and part of what was going to happen as a result of the war was that the empires were going to be severely shaken. The great European empires, which had dominated and continued to dominate so much of the world up until the end of the Second World War, were very shaken by the First World War. Those men who'd come and fought in Europe, whether from India, from French North Africa, from further south in Africa, from the South Pacific, no longer had the same reverence for those who ruled over them, no longer had the same faith that their colonial masters somehow knew better. And many of those who went back to places such as India became nationalist leaders, or went back to North Africa, became nationalist leaders. So they took ideas and attitudes and changed attitudes from Europe around the world. What they also took, tragically, when they went back to their homelands was the influenza epidemic. The epidemic, which was starting just in the last days of the war, tended to hit young people, and of course the soldiers were young, they were healthy, and many of them, as they moved home, took the epidemic with them around the world. We don't know how many died in that great epidemic. It's been estimated as many as 50 million people died around the world. And so the First World War left scars in so many ways, and you can all think of them yourselves. It also, for Canada, was a formative moment in Canadian history. And one of the things I'd like to do is just talk for a few moments about what the war meant to Canada, because Canada, of course, shared in the war, shared in the consequences, shared in the impact of the war, but in a very particularly Canadian way. When the First World War started, Canada found itself at war. Canada did not declare war. It made no decision to go to war. Canada found itself at war because it was part of the British Empire. And so when the British Empire went to war, Canada went to war. It's a mark of how different things were by 1939 that when Britain went to war in the autumn, late summer of 1939, Canada waited for some 5 days to declare war on its own. And that it was making a point that by 1939, Canada had full control over its own decisions whether to go to war or not, full control over its own foreign policy. But in 1914, it was not really questioned, either in Canada or Britain, that Britain, London, had the right to make policy for the empire as a whole and to decide whether the empire was at war or not. And of course, for many Canadians, particularly English-speaking Canadians, this was as it should be. Canadians, again, particularly English-speaking ones, many of them had only moved recently, or their parents had only moved recently from the British Isles. A great majority of English-speaking Canadians had some sort of family link with the British Isles. And they saw themselves as, yes, Canadian, because a Canadian identity was emerging, but they saw themselves as the Canadian part of the British Empire. And they saw themselves as citizens of the British Empire, subjects of the British King. And they did not, in those days, make a distinction between being Canadian and being part of the British Empire. But what you could see, even before the First World War, was Canadians beginning to think of themselves as in some ways significantly different from the British, more energetic, more vigorous. You've got a lot of Canadians talking about how we may come from British stock, but we live in a healthier climate, we're out of doors more, and we're not like those weedy people from London or from Birmingham or from Manchester. We're more independent. And you get this in the South African War, where Canadians fight. Certain sense that we are, yes, we're part of the British race, and they use race in those terms when today we'd say nation. We're part of the British nation, but we're somehow different. We're developing in slightly different ways. We have more vigor, we have more energy. And that Canadian identity was going to be very much strengthened and enhanced by the First World War. Canada became collectively very much aware of what it was contributing to the war effort, as did other parts of the empire. And I think it's fair to say that without the empire, Britain could not have sustained the war effort, and that the Allied victory might well not have occurred. The empire made a huge contribution to the Allied victory in the First World War. Manpower. This was a war which consumed men, and so the more men you could find to replace those who died or been wounded, the more men you could put into the battlefield, the more likely you were to have an advantage over the enemy. But it was also a war that consumed raw materials. It was a war that consumed manufactured goods. It was a war that consumed money. And in all of those things, from manpower to money, the empire played a really important part in the Allied war effort. And Canadians became increasingly aware of just how important they were to the war effort. And you can see it in the dealings that Sir Robert Borden, the Canadian Prime Minister, who was Prime Minister at the beginning of the war and Prime Minister through to the end, you could see it in his dealings with the British government. At the beginning of the war, he's quite polite. And he says to his High Commissioner in London, he said, could you find out from the British government what it's thinking of doing? I mean, don't bother them too much, but could you just find out what their sort of plans are? 2 years later, he's not deferential at all. 2 years later, he's literally or figuratively banging his hand on the table saying, this is not good enough. We need to know what's happening. You're not keeping us posted. We want a share in the direction of the war. And by 1917, he's also saying, we want a share in the peace that is going to come at the end of the war. We want to be consulted. We do not want to be taken for granted. And Australia was doing much the same thing, and New Zealand was beginning to do the same thing. And so you see a real shift in Canadian sense of themselves as being important to the empire, and a real shift in their willingness to push the British and to say very clearly what they think. And I think this is an important moment for Canada. It's a moment when we begin to grow up a bit. I mean, our evolution as a nation has always been a peaceful one. And it's been incremental. There's never been a single moment where Canada becomes an independent nation. But you can see certain moments in Canadian history where we move faster down that road to full independence. And the First World War is certainly one of those moments. Now, this was not always easy for Canadians. And moving towards full independence can be difficult. And of course, if you're moving towards greater independence during a war, it can be very painful and very costly. And Canada paid a price for its involvement in the First World War. Canadians who were killed, and their graves, of course, are still in France or Belgium or sometimes here. Canadians who went home never really properly to recover. And the war also imposed tremendous strains on Canadian society, as it did on all the societies that were involved in the war. There were strains with labor because prices were rising faster than wages. And so there was increased labor unrest. There were changes in Canadian society as women had to play a greater part because the men had gone off to fight, and many societies involved in the war were to feel similar strains. And of course, in Canada, we also had the political tensions between the French-speaking part of Canada, focused in Quebec, and the rest, because understandably, French Canadians, French-speaking Canadians, did not feel the same, or not many of them did not feel the same need to defend the British Empire. They didn't feel any particular ties with France. Those ties had really attenuated over the centuries. And so there was tension between English-speaking Canadians and French-speaking Canadians, which was going to go on affecting Canadian politics into the 20s and 30s. It was a real crisis over the introduction of conscription, which was to leave very lasting scars on Canadian society and to lead to the development of two really quite poisonous myths, and I think they were myths, that French Canadians didn't want to fight, which is not true. The level of volunteering in French-speaking Canada was pretty much as high as the level of volunteering in English-speaking Canada, but also led to a myth in French Canada that the English would always impose what they wanted to do on the French. And this was something that was going to really bedevil Canadian politics for many years. And so Canada paid a price for its involvement in the war at many different levels. But it did, I think, for better or worse, contribute to the development of a sense of a Canadian nation. And some of the things that happened in the war became part of a Canadian story that Canadians told themselves. The Battle of Vimy Ridge, which is often portrayed in Canadian history as if it was fought entirely by Canadians, when in fact it wasn't. And there are a great many other people, British and French, at Vimy Ridge, but it has become a very important part of the Canadian story. It's very noticeable in the 1920s and 1930s that politicians would refer back to battles in the First World War, and Vimy was one that they often referred to, as a moment where the nation came together, as a moment where Canadians felt they were Canadian, as a moment where Canadians joined in a common cause. And I think that's something which we still have echoes of today. At the peace conference at the end of the war, Canada insisted on playing a very important part. There was a tremendous sort of uproar, and indeed something close to a scene, in December 1918, when the British, foolishly I think, said to the Empire representatives, which included Sir Robert Borden from Canada, we will represent you all at the peace conference. You may come, but we'll speak for you. And there was a tremendous sort of agitation, and Borden, Canadian Prime Minister, and Willie Hughes, the Australian Prime Minister, said no. They said, we will be part of whatever delegation goes to Paris, and it will not be a British delegation, it will be a British Empire delegation. And the British, many of them were unpleasantly surprised. They weren't used to the Empire talking like this, but they were going to have to get used to it. And Borden actually threatened to go back to Canada. He said, I'll pack my trunks and go back if we don't have a proper British Empire delegation. And so the Canadians went to Paris as part of a British Empire delegation, but they also went in their own right. And so Canadians participated in the discussions on drawing the new borders in Europe. Canadians participated in the setting up of the League of Nations. Canada, as did Australia, insisted on joining the League of Nations in its own right. It wasn't going to join as part of the British Empire. Canada insisted, as did Australia, in signing the treaties in its own right. It was a tremendous sort of, seems ridiculous now, but symbols can be very important, a tremendous back and forth. And the British said, we'll sign on behalf of the Empire. And the Canadians said, no, we will not support the peace unless we sign it separately. And so the final compromise, and you can see it on the various treaties, is that the British sign and then indented below the Canadian sign, the Australian sign, the New Zealander sign. Now, these seem silly now, but these are important moments. I mean, Canada felt itself playing a part on the world stage, and it never really went back from that. Canadians become increasingly, and Canada becomes increasingly independent in the 1920s and 1930s. And so the First World War, for all the loss, for all the waste, for all the costs to Canada, for all the strains that it imposed on Canadian society, was actually a very important episode in Canadian history. And it's one of the reasons, I think, that we're thinking about it today. But I think we should also remember that we are thinking about the First World War as part of an interconnected world. And so our interest as Canadians, and for those of you who aren't Canadians, I think is not just in what it meant for individual countries. And one of the things that I and other historians have been arguing for is to commemorate the war as something that affected all the world, something that did not just affect the French or the Germans or the British. And we've been asking, Hugh Strawn at Oxford has been very vocal on this, we've been asking that governments and those commemorating the war try to move beyond the national commemorations. It's very important to commemorate it nationally, but we can also, I think of it as an international phenomenon, as something that affects the world as a whole. And I think one of the perhaps good things that has come out of this anniversary of the war is it's made us think again about the war itself and about how wars start. And I think this is important, and it's an important moment to be thinking about such things. There are ways in which 2014 is rather unpleasantly like 1914. And this, I think, is worrying. We are in a world in which what had been a hegemonic power is no longer as strong as it was, is beginning to feel itself pushed by newer and more vigorous rivals. In 1914, that was the British Empire. And the British, through their empire, through their navy, through their enormous industrial and economic capacity, had really dominated much of the world before 1914. They were the key power in the world, and they were the power that had really helped to maintain a sort of order in the world, of course, to the benefit of Britain, but nevertheless had maintained a sort of order. And that was beginning to come under, that position of Britain was beginning to come under pressure by 1914. Britain was being challenged in the New World by the United States, being challenged, of course, by Germany in Europe, and being challenged by Japan in the Far East. And Britain's share of world industrial production was beginning to go down in ways which are rather reminiscent of what's beginning to happen to the United States today. The United States is no longer as dominant as it was. It's still the world's great power, it's still the world's great military power, but increasingly that power is being challenged by other powers, by China, for example, by India, being challenged again by Russia. And so we live in a time of possible transition, and these are not always easy times. What is also reminiscent of the world of 1914 is that we have international ideologies, which can be quite powerful. In the years before 1914, international revolutionary socialism, anarchism, were in fact quite powerful forces, perhaps never as powerful as governments assumed, but there's always a certain amount of fear in these things. Because you don't know who the revolutionaries might be. They often look like you, they often live next door. And there was real fear in Europe of assassinations, of terrorist activities, and there had been quite a bit of this before 1914. So there was fear that somehow the very foundations of society were being undermined. And I think we have similar fears today, although what we fear now more, I think, are revolutionary ideologies fueled by religion. There is a fear of Islamism, And again, I think it reflects the sort of fears that were there before 1914. We don't know how powerful it is, and therefore there's always a danger that we'll panic because we can't really get a handle on it. And again, another similarity, of course, is in nationalism. I mean, we thought that ethnic nationalisms was something that had disappeared as the 20th century came to an end, and we found that that's not true at all. And ethnic nationalism can be a very powerful, very disruptive force. It can push against established organizations. People are prepared to work for it, in some cases, die for it. And in the years before 1914, ethnic nationalism was also very strong. And so I think we're looking back collectively, both thinking about our own national stories in the First World War, but we're also looking back as a global society and thinking, what does that war mean for us? And is there anything we can learn from it? Now, I don't think that we can ever learn anything very clear from history, or you can learn whatever you want. If you're looking for lessons in history, you can find whatever lessons you choose. And if you're looking for justification for what you want to do, you can find whatever justification you want. But I think what history can do, and I was saying this to someone beforehand, what history can do is give us ways of thinking about the present, help us to formulate questions, give us some warnings. And I sometimes think history is like a series of signs on a road. And those of you who just came from London may have noticed signs saying warning, queue ahead, or warning, accident ahead, or warning, road gets slippery when it rains. And I think history can provide similar sorts of warnings. And so we look back at the First World War, and we look at how it started. And this is something that I myself have spent quite a lot of time on, because it is one of the great puzzles. And it's one of the things that worries us, I think, when we think about our own war. If we don't know how the First World War started, do we have any hope of preventing war in future? And the trouble with the First World War, and one of the reasons that it is so much written about, is we don't know. And that's really rather alarming. The closest answer I can come to is it may well have started through a series of stupid assumptions and an accident, which I think is rather frightening. But I think what we need to remember, and looking at the period before the First World War, I think can help us to remember, is that in any society, there are always forces pushing towards conflict and forces pulling away from it or pushing towards peace. And that it's not foreordained that we're going to go down one road or the other. I think we have to remember the importance of human decisions, and we have to remember how important it is to have an informed citizenry and how important it is to build up the institutions which can move us in the direction we want to go. And I'm hoping for most of us, it's the direction of peace rather than the direction of war. And I think that's why looking back at the period before the First World War can at least remind us of some of that and maybe teach us some things that we should be careful about. The trouble with trying to explain the origins of the First World War is that there are so many possible explanations. You can look at the great impersonal forces in history. You can look at things like nationalism. You can look at things like economic rivalries. You can look at things like imperial rivalries. You can look at things like militarism. And all these, I think, are important and perhaps help to create the atmosphere and the ways of thinking in which people think, oh, maybe a war is a good, or a useful thing. But you could also look at the policies of individual nations. You can look at the policies of the British Empire, for example, which perhaps, as the dominant power, was not sensitive enough to the fears and needs of lesser powers. And when you're a great power, you don't have to be tactful. And the British often weren't tactful. They didn't really, I think, understand how Germany felt that as a new and increasingly economically powerful nation, that it deserved a place in the sun. And the British, I think, were not really sensitive to that. Perhaps as the United States has not been entirely sensitive to the sensitivities, the fears, the worries of the Chinese or the Russians. So I think the British, you could look at British policy saying they could have done more to maintain the peace. You can look at French policy. You can say the French should not have formed an alliance with Russia, which made Germany feel encircled. You could look at German policy and say the Germans should not have tried to challenge Britain for naval dominance on the oceans because that was bound to lead to trouble. So you can look at national policies, you could look at impersonal forces, and then of course you can look at the individuals. And it's very hard not to look at some of them, very hard not to look at Kaiser Wilhelm II, whose life was devoted to getting people to look at him. I mean, he's like one of these children who jumps up and down and says, pay attention to me. And he wanted to have attention paid to him, and he often said very stupid things and gave the impression of a Germany that was slightly out of control and very belligerent. And then I think you can look at the final decisions which took Europe into war. But as we do that, I think very important to remember, and important to remember in our own day, that there are, in any society, forces for peace as well. And one of Europe's tragedies and the world's tragedies before the First World War was that the forces for peace were actually quite strong. There was a very strong middle-class peace movement, which was talking and organizing and agitating for other ways to settle disputes than going to war. And one of the things that people were very enthusiastic about, and there's a great deal of public support for, and indeed support among governments, was arbitration as a way of settling disputes among nations, where two nations would agree to go to a third person or third party arbiter and agree to be bound by whatever decision there was. There were some 300 arbitrations held between 1794 and 1914. More than half of those were held after 1890. And so you could, if you look back, and people felt at the time, you could see a movement towards peace rather than towards war. And there was also a very big international socialist movement which constantly said that it would not fight, its members would not fight in a war of the capitalists, that it would probably go on strike, call on all its members to go on strike, which would have meant a war on the scale of the First World War, the Great War, would have been impossible. And so you have a Europe that was very much, it was a tense continent, it was a very prosperous part of the world, it was the dominant part of the world, but there were tensions, there were rivalries among nations, there were fears of revolution at home. In some ways, it's not unlike our world, certainly those of us who come from North America, from Western Europe. We live in a world that is very prosperous, but we are, I think, aware of tensions in our own world, and we're worried about what's happening in the rest of the world, and that, I think, is very much the world of 1914. But in the end, I think, if we have to understand the First World War, and this may be where we really should be very careful about what we do in our own world, what we have to remember is, in my view at least, it didn't have to happen. You know, there's a danger in looking at the First World War and saying there were so many possible reasons it could have happened, it was bound to happen. And I think very few things in this world, particularly in human affairs, are bound to happen. You can see things moving in a certain direction, but they don't have to reach their final culmination in either war or peace. If you had lived through the Cold War, as I did, and as many of you did, you would have said, and most of us said at the time, we're bound to have a war at some point. The tensions are so high, and they got particularly high at certain moments, Cuban Missile Crisis, for example, or the shooting down of KAL-007 in 1983, that people really were expecting an all-out nuclear war between the two blocs, the Western Bloc and the Eastern Bloc. Yet it didn't happen, and I think we have to remind ourselves of that. Wars don't have to happen, and the First World War didn't have to happen. I think what made 1914 a particularly dangerous year was that there had been a number of crises and Europe had got through them. And that led to a very dangerous complacency. And I think we sometimes suffer for that in our own world. And I've grown up, at least in North America, in a world in which there has not been war. And so I've come to assume, as many of us have, that it's the normal state of affairs. And I think we need to be reminded that it's not necessarily the normal state of affairs, that countries and the world can go very quickly from peace into war. It only took 5 weeks for Europe and the world to go into a major war in 1914. 5 weeks is a very short time in human history. And so I think there was a dangerous complacency. There had been a series of crises before 1914 which had been settled. And in each crisis, there'd been talk of war, talk of a general war, there'd been threats, there'd been even mobilization of armies, of forces to put pressure on the other side. There'd been people saying, we won't back down this time. But in fact, things had been settled. So there'd been a crisis, for example, in 1906, another crisis in 1908, crisis in 1911, 1912, there was the First Balkan War, when all of these brought talk of general war, 1913, a second Balkan War. And so what happened in the summer of 1914, as the crisis began to develop, as people said, oh, it's just another crisis. We're used to it. We know what'll happen. There'll be a lot of back and forth. There'll be a lot of talk about war. There'll be some perhaps military maneuvers. Someone might move troops up a bit closer to the frontier, but it won't happen. On the 27th of July, that is less than a week, just about a week before the war became a general war, the 27th of July, the editor of the big evening Berlin newspaper was planning to take his family, as he always did every summer, to the Belgian seaside resort of Ostend, right on the invasion route, or very close to the invasion route of the German armies, if they were going to go into France. And he talked to his friend, the German foreign secretary, and said, look, things seem a bit tense at the moment. I mean, you know, there does seem to be a bit of, you know, things are more tense than I remember. Should I take my family on holiday? Oh, yes, said his friend, the German foreign secretary, by all means. There's not going to be a war. It's just talk. And so he took his family to Belgium, went back to Berlin to cover the stories, and of course 2 days later had to go back and get them out, and got them out just in time. So there was a very, very dangerous sort of complacency that the war is not going to come, it can't come, this is just a crisis like other ones. The other thing that made the summer of 1914 dangerous, however, was that certain people in certain powers had decided that this time in the crisis they wouldn't back down as they had backed down before. And so you get Russia, which was the patron of Serbia, which had not really fully supported Serbia in either of the two Balkan wars, saying now, or at least key people in Russia saying, we have to back Serbia this time if Austria-Hungary threatens it, because if we don't back Serbia, we lose all status as a great power. We might as well give up. We won't be considered a great power anymore. We will have lost all credibility. And you get Austria-Hungary saying, and of course this is fatal, saying we won't put up with any more provocations from Serbia. We've had it with Serbia. They're a menace, they're a nasty little power on our southern borders. They're talking to our own Serbs, our own Croatians, our own Slovenes, urging them to leave Austria-Hungary and join with them. It'll be the death of Austria-Hungary. And so this time, at least key people in Austria-Hungary said, we can't put up with any more from Serbia. We have to destroy it before it causes any more trouble for us and possibly our own disappearance as an empire. And so this time we won't back down. Even if Russia comes in, we are not backing down this time. And the third thing that makes the crisis of 1914 very dangerous is that certain countries were afraid of losing their allies. Germany was afraid of losing Austria-Hungary. They hadn't really properly backed them before in previous crises, or Austria-Hungary certainly felt so. So this time, the Germans feel they've got to back them, or they will lose Austria-Hungary. And Germany's problem, as the German Foreign Secretary said, is we've allied ourselves to that crumbling collection of states on the Danube. We are being dragged into their fights, but if we don't back them, who else have we got? We don't have any other friends. And so Germany finds itself in the position of feeling it has to back Austria-Hungary, or it will lose it. France is very much in the same position with Russia. It feels it has to back Russia. It doesn't want to restrain Russia from going to Serbia's aid because it's afraid it will lose Russia. And if it loses Russia, then it will be left at the mercy of Germany. And that is something that very few French people can contemplate. And so 1914 is dangerous in part because of what's happened before, but what people are remembering, what lessons, what mixed lessons they have taken from it. And then again, finally, we get accident. If the Archduke's chauffeur had not taken that wrong turning in Sarajevo on the 28th of June and gone down a narrow road, had to stop, had to back up, if one of the assassins, the only one who hadn't either been caught or run away, had not been standing there with his revolver as the car containing the people he wanted to kill came to a stop right in front of him, we might not have had the First World War. The assassination of the Archduke, and even bad shots like me could not have missed at that range. I mean, it was an open touring car, he just stood there and shot them, but as close as you are, or closer. If he had not been successful, if he had not killed the Archduke, Austria-Hungary would not have had the reason that it needed to try to destroy Serbia. And so accident, I think, plays a role. Misassumptions play a role. Stupid decisions play a role. And I think what we all have to hope that we don't get into a similar situation where people will feel themselves pressured to make decisions, feel themselves pressured, as so many of those in 1914 were, to gamble, that we will risk a war because who knows, we might win and we can't resist the pressures towards war. So not a cheerful note on which to end, but I think it is a time to remember. And I think as you listen to the concert tonight, some of the music from that, well, the Brook Violin Concerto was written by someone who, of course, experienced the First World War. So I hope that perhaps we'll all reflect on how important it is to think of ways of strengthening peace and how dangerous it can be when people start making these miscalculations. Anyway, sorry, I'm losing my voice, but I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have. Excuse me.